Good afternoon, good people out there. And this week again, I speak to another celebrated BBC journalist, Yusuf Dayo. And he will speak to you about himself. And of course, welcome to Uganda.
Thank you very much.
Salam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Yusuf, tell us more about yourself that possibly most of us do not know about.
A lot of my life is very much out there. So if I was going to zero down on what people don't know about, let me just run through it. I am a Kenyan. I was born and raised in Nairobi. I've worked as a journalist in Kenya for different organizations so far. And I'm doing something that I love.
Tell us what you were doing before being a journalist.
I would say I've always been a journalist. First of all, I come from a family of journalists. My own mother was a radio journalist. She worked with the National Broadcaster for many years. Well, since I was born, I found her working as a journalist. So, and I've got three of her brothers are journalists in Kenya. So journalism talk was the thing in the house. And I am the one, apparently, out of five kids who picked up that line and really got interested in it. So even through high school, I remember my mother once asked us over dinner and said, has any of you ever thought of imagined yourself after school? What do you think you would be doing? And of course, there's always somebody who says they want to be a pilot. There's always a doctor. I didn't even say I want to be a journalist, actually. Surprisingly, I said, I want to work for BBC.
Wow. You're working for BBC now?
And now I'm working for BBC, which is a conversation my mother reminded me the day I called her and said, guess what, I've been offered a job at BBC. And she said, this is exactly what she talked about that day. And I'd forgotten about this conversation. She reminded me. So anyway, since I always wanted to be a journalist, and I expressed this to her, and I knew she was a very good journalist, so she offered to sort of teach me. So I had something like home teaching on being a journalist. So I remember growing up, she would bring back from work scripts from the newsroom, and she'd go. Sometimes she'd make me translate stories from English, Swahili or Swahili to English, just sort of to give me practice, because she really pushed me to be bilingual. So I did a lot of that, and she would make me read scripts. She would be in the kitchen and send me off to the living room and said, you're not loud enough, you're not clear enough. Can you read that script again? So it was something that people mocked us in the house, like mother and son just playing journalism in the house. But I enjoyed it. And that also gave me a lot of connection with my mom anyway. And so I sort of just built on that. In high school, I became at some point president of the journalism club. So we used to do school magazines, school reports, you know, just random things. We'd go out and find interesting things to write about in school, and then sit in the library, do a script. But we didn't have a mentor in school for journalism. So the only link we had was our language teacher. What they would do is just go through the language that it's written well in terms of scripting. And then we'd be given, permission to publish it, and it's sold in the school only. So I sort of started my writing and reporting then. But then immediately after high school, I was called, as I was joining college, I was called to go for an audition for newsreading. KBC, which is the national broadcaster in Kenya, they were looking for newsreaders, plain newsreaders. They didn't want any journalists or someone who just sits in the studio and reads news. So I thought this is a perfect gateway for me, and I went for the audition. I got the job, but it turned out to be a different thing eventually. I read the script as I was doing my audition, and the panelists, I remember, stopped me halfway through. Then they discussed for almost 5 minutes without engaging me, and I'm sitting there in front of people. And then suddenly they said, could you just leave those scripts alone? And we put something on the side there, pick it up and read it. When I looked at it, it was greetings. There's a very popular show in Kenya where people just send greetings to their loved ones, yes, to the radio show, and the presenter will just keep reading. We used to make fun of the people who did that because we found it was shady. Why would you want to call and say, I'd like to say hi to my friend, and then you list a long list of friends. So growing up as kids, you know, oh, these people are boring, because they used to do it over musical shows. So they interrupted the music to read greetings for people we don't know. So it wasn't my kind of thing, but they made me read it. So when I read it, then they said, you know what, forget the news reading for now. We want you to go into the studio and do this greetings show, and you get a chance to play music. So I wanted any job that would get me in anyway. So I said, I'm happy to do that. What do I need to do? Because by then I was not trained to work in the studio. They said, don't worry about that. We'll show you the few things you need to know about the studio.
Basics.
Yeah. And you can operate, at least play music, and how to select music from the computer. And then you have the leeway to select whichever music you want.
So that's how you joined the MC?
That's how I started being the MC. Oh, so okay. I started playing, doing the Salam. We call it the Salams show, which means greetings. So I did it for a few weeks. Actually, it didn't even last long. And I went to my boss, said, listen, I have an idea of a music show that I think I can do. I mean, I was young, but that time I was 20 years old. So I wanted to do something fun in the studio. And she said, you know what? You are good already. You've established yourself as a presenter in the studio. People like your voice on radio, and because you are young, we don't want to lock you in this show, because most of the people who are doing it were older. So I said, just leave it to the old people. You do your music show. So I now had time to research, get as much music as possible, go into the studio. I had no limitations, as long as I had rights to play the music. And it was easy because I did a youth music show, which was playing music from East Africa. But then I had a chance to interview local artists, which was even more fun for me. So on my show, it was very casual. I didn't even have a producer, it was just me. So I would go around, if I meet a producer, and I wanted to work mostly with the new
upcoming
musicians. So I would meet musicians in the street. Some would come looking for me, saying, hey, I have a new song. I say, how many songs have you recorded? I only have recorded this one song in a CD. I said, okay, fine. Come to the studio on this date. We talk about your music and you play your music. So that's how I did more of that. And for almost 1.5 years, I just played music and talking to artists.
So this is the kind of a show you didn't want at first. You were missing and now you're loving.
What I learned is these things grow on you, or you make them fun. I was doing a greetings show, which I did. That is what I did not want. But I loved the part where I was playing all the music I wanted. And I could say whatever I wanted to say over the music. So I would make fun of people, say hi to some of my friends, because it was exciting. I was with my colleagues from high school. I was the one who's, most people were then just in university, joining college. And I'm on air. So I had the opportunity to make fun of them, and I would play music and call out their names, and they would call me after the show saying how embarrassed they are because they heard their name on the radio. That only made me do it more. But I started loving it. Then the part I didn't like, I removed it. Now I just did music and friends, and people would call in and say, request for songs. So yeah, that's how it grew on me.
And then later in your life, you drift away to news journalism.
Well, yeah, now that is the interesting bit.
Why?
Why I got into news?
Yes.
I got into news because I was taken into news. What happened in KBC during elections, because KBC is owned by the state, so they're basically working for the state. So during elections, the Electoral Commission of Kenya works with KBC to give out whatever. So that's the official mouthpiece of the Electoral Commission of Kenya. So all official information, reports, anything coming from the Electoral Commission to the nation was taken to KBC. So what KBC does now is, well, since then, is during elections, they will dispatch one journalist in every constituency in the country. We didn't have that many journalists working at that time. So what happens is the big, what they call the red spots and the hot zones, you know, places where you expect action during election, they would send the big shots from the newsroom, the big reporters. And then the other places that are basically very quiet, we only expect to hear voting has started, voting has closed, these are the number of votes, there's nothing much happening.
Not much to do.
Yes. Anybody would be sent there. So by anybody, that's where we come in. People who are not journalists. So when I came back, because I was, you know, nervous, I kept filing reports. Every hour I would call the office and say, I have a new report, I have a new report. Not knowing that most people are not doing that. People are just filing the necessary.
The
voting
basics.
Voting has started, voting has ended, unless there's an incident in between. Otherwise, they were not bothering. But because I was nervous, I kept filing. And when I came back, they did sort of a report of the people who did the best in this election. And I was listed among the people who did very well. And then my boss said, I think you're wasting your talent playing music in the studio. You need to be in the newsroom. And that's how I was officially put in news.
Now hold it over there. When we come back from that break, we shall continue the conversation.